For our next session, the focus is on the legal questions and legal ramifications of online anti-Semitism. There are many who ask why we don't simply enact laws and regulations that ban expressions of anti-Semitism on the internet. To help us understand more on the legal framework and legal ramifications of online anti-Semitism, we are honored to have with us U.S. Deputy Attorney General Jeffrey Rosen, speaking on the Department of Justice's efforts against anti-Semitic acts, what can and cannot be pursued under federal law. The Deputy Attorney General will be followed by Robert Peter George, the McCormick Professor of Jurisprudence at Princeton University, who will address issues arising under the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. And finally, we will hear from Aliza Lewin, President and General Counsel of the Brandeis Center for Human Rights Under Law, who will discuss Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act.
Hello. I want to first thank Secretary Pompeo and Special Envoy Carr for hosting this conference and for inviting me to participate. As we have heard, the internet is just the latest outlet for the oldest hatred. The litany of attacks on the Jewish people has gone on through every era of history. We should not be surprised then, even though it saddens us, that it is a part of our modern world. And since that world depends on the internet for communication, commerce, and daily life, anti-Semites can use it for their purposes as much as anyone else can use it for legitimate causes. Given this history and the reality of our dependence on technology, perhaps we will find ourselves unable to permanently sever the connection between anti-Semitism and the internet. But as Rabbi Tarfon says in the Mishnah's Ethics of the Fathers, quote, "It is not incumbent on you to complete the work, but neither can you desist from doing it." So the key thing I want to make clear today is that the Department of Justice will not tolerate anti-Semitic acts that violate federal law, whether they occur on the internet or elsewhere. As the title for today's conference suggests, we face an unfortunate and uncomfortable truth. Anti-Semitism remains a serious problem and one that seems to have worsened over the last decade in terms of violent incidents. For example, in April of this year, the Department of Justice announced an arrest and charges for attempted arson at a Jewish assisted living facility in Massachusetts. It's also disturbing that anti-Semitism seems increasingly prevalent in public discourse. Sometimes it comes from the usual suspects like neo-Nazis, followers of Louis Farrakhan, or BDS activists. But other times we're startled to see it from more respected sources. Consider when an NFL star like DeSean Jackson tweeted a fake Hitler quote about Jews controlling America, and he was endorsed and defended by former NBA player Steven Jackson. Or when someone who claimed to be a civil rights advocate like Rodney Muhammad posted an anti-Semitic cartoon on his public Facebook page. Now let me also add that not every reference to Jewish people is anti-Semitic. For example, I reject the assertion that every criticism of political activities funded by George Soros is anti-Semitic. In addition, there are times that bigoted statements are animated by ignorance rather than malice and are followed by a willingness to stand corrected and to learn, as appears to be the case in one or two recent incidents. But the problems on the internet go beyond abhorrent expressions. The outbreak of Zoom bombing is another illustration. Zoom bombing occurs when someone uninvited interrupts and disrupts a video conference. Some Zoom bombing may be relatively harmless, such as when a coworker's child makes a guest appearance. Other instances, however, are far more troubling. Zoom bombers have targeted hateful or threatening messages at synagogue services, scripture classes, school board meetings, and meetings in areas with large Jewish populations, and at a rally for a Jewish candidate running for lieutenant governor of Vermont. All anti-Semitic incidents are offensive and unacceptable, but not all rise to the level of federal crimes. Some do. Those include violence, plots to commit violence, and other crimes against synagogues and religious property. Let me mention two real cases that involve use of the internet. One involved an online chat group where just in the last month, a member of a white supremacist group called Adam Waffen pled guilty to federal charges for conspiring and making threats of violence targeted at Black and Jewish journalists, as well as at members of the Anti-Defamation League. In another incident, last November, a man was charged for a federal hate crime for threatening to blow up a synagogue in Pueblo, Colorado. He allegedly organized much of his plot online, where he repeatedly expressed his hatred of Jewish people and his desire to destroy the synagogue. Addressing this disturbing rise of anti-Semitism is a priority of the Justice Department. Let me briefly mention a few steps we have taken. First, the department has been listening to and learning from the Jewish community. Last summer, the Attorney General convened the first ever DOJ Summit on Combating Anti-Semitism, which brought together 150 community leaders and allies. This year, the Attorney General also traveled to Brooklyn to meet with a group of Jewish leaders to hear their concerns about a wave of anti-Semitic attacks in New York City. Second, we want Jewish communities to know where to report potential crimes. Earlier this year, the Attorney General directed U.S. attorneys throughout the country to reach out to Jewish leaders in their districts to assure them of support and to provide them with personal contacts for reporting anti-Semitic hate crimes. Third, and most importantly, we have prioritized investigating and prosecuting anti-Semitic crimes. Faith-based communities have been targeted in their places of worship, their grocery stores, and their community centers. One report cited 234 incidents targeting synagogues and community centers in 2019. By now, some of the worst cases have become well known. The Pittsburgh Tree of Life synagogue, where there was murder of 11 worshipers. The Chabad of Poway, California synagogue shootings that killed one and injured 53 others. And the Jersey City murders, where two individuals, after killing a police detective, drove to a kosher grocery store and murdered the owner, a worker, and a customer before being killed in a shootout with the police. As these and other cases demonstrate, the Department of Justice has not hesitated to bring hate crime charges and other federal charges in response to anti-Semitic crimes. Since January 2017, the department has charged over 80 defendants with federal hate crimes and related conduct. In that same time frame, the Department of Justice has obtained convictions of more than 65 defendants for the same. So this brings me back to the topic of the internet and what role the Justice Department can play beyond the deadly cases I have already mentioned. And when the issue is solely one of what things people say, we have to acknowledge the need for more education and changing hearts and minds. The reason is that the department vigorously enforces and protects the constitutional rights of all our citizens. So our efforts must remain consistent with the First Amendment and its guarantees of free expression as construed by the Supreme Court. Given that, no matter how much we are disgusted by anti-Semitism, we do not and cannot impinge on free speech, even the most offensive by the most odious of speakers. When dealing with things that involve or implicate speech, the department is limited to prosecuting crimes that fall under recognized categories of unprotected speech or that otherwise satisfy the First Amendment's very exacting standards. The department can and does prosecute what the Supreme Court has called true threats, that is, quote, a serious expression of an intent to commit an act of unlawful violence to a particular individual or group of individuals. Close quote. Where anti-Semitic tirades constitute true threats, federal prosecution can punish and deter such conduct. For example, in March of this year, federal agents arrested a self-proclaimed white nationalist in Washington state who allegedly posted anti-Semitic rants about the victim online, including threats to kill the victim and others. That individual was charged with making interstate threats and cyberstalking. That case is scheduled for trial later this year. The First Amendment also offers no protection for speech that is integral to criminal conduct. In the context of anti-Semitism on the internet, this means the department will not hesitate to prosecute those who cyberstalk, extort, cyberhack, defraud, or otherwise commit crimes in the course of their hateful screeds. Sometimes it can be difficult to parse whether an incident of anti-Semitism rises to the level of a federal crime. For example, is Zoom bombing a federal crime? It depends. Although Zoom bombing is generally disruptive and unwelcome, whether the conduct rises to the level of criminal behavior will turn on very specific facts. Investigators must consider whether a true threat was made, whether there was criminal harassment or stalking, whether there was intentional unauthorized access to or damage to a computer, or if another criminal statute was violated. Not all anti-Semitism will meet the standard of a federal crime. But make no mistake, the Department of Justice and the administration as a whole have unequivocally condemned hateful attacks against Jews, and we have prosecuted them when they involve violations of federal criminal laws, including hate crimes and true threats of violence, among others. Now, I'd like to suggest, however, that at least in the realm of the law, we should look to find a better term than the phrase hate speech, as that term can cover some things that are protected by the First Amendment and some that are not. So it's not proven to be a very useful term. And sometimes the term hate speech has been misused to label whatever the person using the phrase doesn't like. It's become too easy to label political speech as such. The vagueness and malleability of what counts as hate could wrongly be deployed to shut down constitutionally protected speech. I have seen some harsh criticism of political leaders that did not sound much like love or affection. Likewise, the label might be used against speech that challenges prevailing orthodoxies or politically correct ideas, but is deemed objectionable by someone who does not wish to hear dissent or opposition. We should not want honest debate silenced, or even heated disagreements about public policy, schools, society, or public issues. Instead, the concern we ought to have is about vile attacks on people based on illegitimate group stereotypes that constitute threats of violence or generate actual violence or other unlawful actions. On the internet, as elsewhere, threats and violence have no safe haven. But on the internet, we have to find ways to condemn genuine bigotry and prejudice while still tolerating disagreements about public issues and recognizing the limits of what the law can do in a free society that values free speech. Those are issues that the department also has been considering in the context of legislative immunities that exist under Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which is something I've publicly addressed elsewhere in the past, but today I'm going to leave that topic for others. Let me wrap up by underscoring again that, consistent with the founding principles and best traditions of our country, the United States Department of Justice stands firmly and unequivocally against anti-Semitism. We will not hesitate to take action where anti-Semitic conduct rises to the level of a federal offense. That is as true online as it is offline. We have no tolerance for that behavior and will continue to prosecute such conduct as appropriate. Most importantly, we will continue to uphold the rule of law for all Americans. So thank you again for inviting me to participate in today's important conference.
Hello, I'm Robert George. I'm McCormick Professor of Jurisprudence at Princeton University and Director of Princeton's James Madison Program in American Ideals and Institutions. I'm honored and grateful for the opportunity to participate in this important event. The ancient curse of anti-Semitism is like a vampire. Every time we think we've killed it and put it in the coffin, somehow it comes back to prowl the night. We never managed to get a dagger into the heart of the monster. But that does not mean we should give up. Far from it. We should continue to work by every possible legitimate means to extirpate the ancient curse. And that's why I'm so delighted to be gathered with you and working hand in hand with all of you in the cause of combating anti-Semitism. Of course, times change and technologies change, ideologies change, but somehow the ancient curse never goes away. New mechanisms, new ideologies are used to justify it, to promote it, and so forth. We live in the age of technology and of social media, and of course, social media are used as tools for promoting anti-Jewish hatred. So we need to take up that challenge and learn to use social media in the cause of combating and ultimately defeating anti-Semitism and anti-Jewish hatred. How do we do that? Well, let me talk a bit about my own experience. A few years ago, I had the honor of serving on the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. I served two terms as the commission's chairman. That commission is an independent United States government agency whose mission is to promote human rights and especially religious liberty in American foreign and diplomatic policy. In that connection, the commission serves as a sort of internal lobby, pressing the State Department, pressing the administration, be it Democrat or Republican, liberal or conservative, pressing those exercising the levers of power in shaping and executing our foreign and diplomatic policy to prioritize religious liberty. And I made it one of my particular missions as chairman of the commission to focus on the, alas, worldwide phenomenon of anti-Semitism. Now, when I embarked on my chairmanship of the commission, I was under what turned out to be the misapprehension that the problem stemmed fundamentally from government, from bad governments, from governments that were anti-Jewish, that were anti-Semitic in places around the world, and that the solutions would mainly have to do with changing government policies in those regimes, pressuring them with economic sanctions and other diplomatic tools to change their ways. I learned, though, that the problem is deeper than that. I should have known it before. In a way, it should be obvious. And that is, governments very, very often simply reflect the underlying realities in civil society, including hatred of Jews and Judaism, including in places where people don't even know any Jews, where there is a very small or even no Jewish population. Somehow, people still direct their animus, their animosity, their hatred toward Jews and Judaism. Now, in dealing with governments around the world, very often government officials would say, gosh, yes, we would like to tone down the anti-Semitism. We would like to have different policies. We would like to have a different sort of rhetoric. But you have to understand we're constrained in what we can and cannot do by the realities of our civil society. This, of course, even in authoritarian regimes. More often than not, those claims were at best half-truths, which my mother always taught me were lies, half-truths are lies. The problem was governments didn't want to change their ways. Anti-Semitism was so deep in the hearts of people who exercised power in those regimes that they did not want to change it, and they were simply trying to shift the blame for their own guilt to the people of their countries. And I tried to be alert to that, as did my colleagues on the commission and our commission staff, and not fall for any such baloney. But sometimes it was true. And most of the time it was, as I say, at least half true. There are deep underlying problems in civil societies across the globe, deep underlying reservoirs of anti-Jewish hatred. I will leave it to the sociologists and the philosophers to diagnose why that should be the case, why there should be hatred of Jews and Judaism, even where there are no Jews, and Judaism is virtually unheard of as a religion. But it is what it is, and we have to combat it. What I found in serving on the commission was that while it was important to pressure governmental officials at all levels, national governments, regional, local governments, it was also critical to look for leaders within civil society, most especially religious leaders of the various faiths, and to turn them and turn their attention toward combating anti-Semitism. I found that it was almost always possible to find at least a leader or two or three, people with credibility among the population, especially again, religious leaders of various faiths. It was always possible to find one or two or three, or perhaps a few more, who did not have anti-Semitism in their hearts, who recognized that it was a problem and an evil. And then the question became, could we prompt them? Could we provoke them? Could we encourage them and support them to speak out, to do something about it? Social media gives those leaders the tools, if they're willing to do it. It gives them the microphone. It amplifies their voices. It enables them to reach out to a broader public, to the people who care about them and their opinions, in the effort to reach hearts and minds and to change hearts and minds. It's not easy. Where anti-Semitism is deep in a culture, any leader, certainly any religious leader, takes a risk in speaking out against anti-Semitism. But where, especially again, religious leaders are willing to do that, the payoff can be very significant. We can probably make more progress in winning hearts and minds, in changing hearts and minds, by engaging the religious leadership, even than by pressuring political leaders. Now, that should never be an excuse for failing to pressure political leaders, especially on matters of policy. But at the same time, we need to remember the importance of civil society, of leaders of civil society, and most especially religious leaders in civil society, and encourage them, facilitate them in using the tools of contemporary technology to combat anti-Semitism with messages of brotherhood and peace. Promoting understanding of Jews and Judaism is a key part of this. So much anti-Semitism is rooted in historical ignorance, itself, of course, grounded in bad faith, in lies. But still people, even sometimes people of goodwill, otherwise people of goodwill, have come to believe this nonsense. They've taken it into their consciousness and into their hearts, alas. And it's got to be dislodged. Now, in many places, they're not going to listen to me. I don't share their religion. I'm not a member of their community or their country. But they will perk up their ears if a respected leader, especially a religious leader, is willing to speak and to use the platform provided by social media to get his message out. So I encourage all of you who are in a position to do this to not give up on the religious leadership in countries where we're combating anti-Semitism. Yes, many times when you knock at the door, it won't be opened, or if it's opened, it'll be slammed in your face. But you will find sometimes that there are leaders who are people of conscience, and they will look for resources within their own traditions of faith to build the message of brotherhood and of peace, and to convey the idea that Jews are not to be hated or held in contempt or accused of ridiculous things that, of course, they have never done and never wrongs they have never committed. Encourage them. Yes, some enemies then will treat them as traitors and vilify them. They need to be people of courage, but they can be found. Sometimes the door will be open and you will be invited in. And then the question is, what can we encourage? What can we do? Encourage people to use social media. It's a reality. It's not going away. I say this to my students all the time. You're going to be living for your entire lives and your children and your grandchildren with social media. We may regret social media. We may say, look at the filth and the sewage in social media. Look at how Bad people can poison the atmosphere, poison the culture through social media. We can wring our hands, we can throw our hands in the air, but social media is not going to go away. And our abstaining from using it certainly is not going to help. No, what we need to do is use it and encourage good people, people of goodwill all across the world to use it to advance good causes. Let me close by reminding you of something you've probably heard from my great friend and one of our world's great religious teachers at the moment, Rabbi Jonathan Sacks, Lord Jonathan Sacks, the former chief rabbi of the United Kingdom. Rabbi Sacks makes the point that anti-Semitism, like just about any other evil that people want to promote or commit, anti-Semitism is always rationalized, justified in the dominant discourse of the time. So in medieval Europe, when the dominant discourse was theological, hatred of Jews and Judaism was promoted in the name of theology, in religious terms. During the Enlightenment, the so-called Age of Reason, the Age of Science, anti-Semitism didn't go away, but it gets transformed and justified, rationalized in the language of rationality and of science. During the rise of nationalism in the 19th and first half of the 20th centuries, anti-Semitism is now justified, rationalized in the language of nationalism. So the Jews are the rootless cosmopolitans with no real loyalty to a nation. Or yes, we'll tolerate Jews, we'll treat them as equals, but only if they give up being Jews, essentially, or relegate their Jewish lives to the purely private sphere. Well, what's the dominant discourse of our time, of our day? It's the discourse of human rights. It's absolutely dominant when it comes to international relations and diplomatic and foreign policy. And sure enough, of course, Rabbi Sacks is right. You find anti-Semitism, hatred of Jews and Judaism, now rationalized, promoted, framed in the language of human rights. Now, that doesn't mean that human rights is a false discourse, but it's a discourse that's very easily hijacked. It is being hijacked, and one of the things it's hijacked for is the promotion of anti-Semitism. We've got to fight back against that. We can't allow this discourse of human rights to be hijacked. And social media can and should be used to push back against that. Human rights should be the cause, or the general cause, in the name of which we combat anti-Semitism or hatred of groups of any sort. Just as anti-Semitism marred faith in an earlier time, it mars the discourse of human rights today. And as I say, we need to fight back. And we need to use these resources, these new technologies, and any new technologies that follow, to push back hard against this hijacking, against anti-Semitism. It's time to drive the stake, finally, through the heart of this vampire.
Good day. My name is Aliza Lewin. I am president of the Louis D. Brandeis Center for Human Rights Under Law, an independent, nonpartisan organization dedicated to public interest legal advocacy, research, and education. Our mission is to advance the civil and human rights of the Jewish people and promote justice for all. As part of my work, I hear nearly each and every day from individuals who are experiencing anti-Semitism. Much of the hate they witness, particularly during this pandemic, is online. Our organization provides these individuals with legal strategic guidance to ensure they understand their rights and are best equipped to defend themselves from unlawful harassment. I want to thank Special Envoy Ilan Carr and Assistant Special Envoy Ephraim Cohn for inviting me to participate in this conference. It is an honor to be included. You have asked me to provide a brief primer on Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, CDA, and to suggest initiatives that could be taken to address online hate, particularly the proliferation of anti-Semitic posts on social media platforms. The Communications Decency Act was enacted in 1996 in the early years of the internet. Section 230 was designed to help technology companies walk a fine line. On the one hand, it was intended to facilitate an open internet where all are free to share thoughts and ideas. On the other hand, its goal was to keep the online space safe by inspiring technology companies to protect the public from illicit, unlawful, and hateful material, including content that incites violence. In 1995, a New York State court issued an opinion that made Section 230 of the CDA necessary. The court held that if an online platform passively hosts third-party content, in other words, if the platform takes no steps at all to moderate content, it just provides a forum where others can post, then the online platform will not be civilly liable if any of the content posted by others is defamatory. However, the court explained, if a platform makes any attempt, no matter how minimal, to moderate content, then the platform will be held responsible for all of its third-party content. So in sum, the court ruled that a company that takes no steps at all to control or edit content is immune from liability, whereas a company that takes even minimal steps to keep its online space safe will be held liable for all third-party content. The result of that opinion was to disincentivize technology companies from making any effort to regulate content on their platforms. Lawmakers rapidly recognized the need to reverse this motivational structure. Section 230 was enacted to incentivize technology companies to self-regulate the new industry. Section 230 includes two key provisions. The first subsection says, and I quote, "No provider or user of an interactive computer service shall be treated as the publisher or speaker of any information provided by another information content provider." Close quote. This subsection provides social media companies with immunity from civil liability for content that is posted by third parties. The second subsection, which was designed to protect Good Samaritans, states, and I quote, "No provider or user of an interactive computer service shall be held liable on account of any action voluntarily taken in good faith to restrict access to or availability of material that the provider or user considers to be obscene, lewd, lascivious, filthy, excessively violent, harassing, or otherwise objectionable, whether or not such material is constitutionally protected." Close quote. This subsection shields from liability companies that remove noxious content in good faith. It protects them regardless of whether they remove too much or too little content, regardless of how effective their monitoring efforts are, and regardless of whether or not the material they remove is constitutionally protected speech. Over the last 25 years, the internet has changed dramatically, and Section 230 is no longer working as it should. Today, social media platforms are not passive hosts for third-party content. Rather, online companies utilize sophisticated algorithms to provide users with tailored content and to connect individuals that have shared interests. In the last quarter century, the public has come to rely on the internet for an ever-increasing array of services. As we've seen during the current pandemic, it sometimes feels as if our entire existence has been moved online. Today, we communicate, do business, get our news, attend school, and socialize all online. As the public has embraced the internet, so too have the criminals, who are increasingly turning to the internet to facilitate their unlawful activity. Wrongdoers utilize the internet for an endless list of malfeasance, including fraud, theft, the sexual exploitation of children, the sale of illicit drugs, human trafficking, cyberstalking, terrorism, and the proliferation of online hate. At the same time that this evil on the internet has exploded, state and federal courts have extended Section 230's protections to companies that, rather than acting as good Samaritans, have actually encouraged illegal activity and deliberately maintained content that is harmful. Both Republicans and Democrats, therefore, agree that the time has come to reform Section 230. How exactly to best effectuate that reform? How to ensure that our online space remains free and open, but also safe, is subject to vigorous debate. There are no easy answers to this challenging question, and not enough time in this brief presentation to discuss all the various legislative fixes that have been proposed. However, since this conference is focused on anti-Semitism, I do have one proposal. Social media platforms should be required to adopt the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, IHRA, working definition of anti-Semitism as a guide and educational tool. One of the greatest challenges we have today when it comes to combating anti-Semitism is that much of society does not understand what anti-Semitism even is. Many of those who think they understand anti-Semitism only recognize as anti-Semitic the anti-Semitism that resembles the Holocaust. If they see a swastika, for example, or they hear a Nazi or white supremacist, they know that that is anti-Semitic. Or if they learn that someone who is identifiably Jewish, such as a man with side curls or a yarmulke, was stabbed, or worshippers at a synagogue were attacked, they may also recognize that as anti-Semitic. A disturbing recent study suggests that two-thirds of young adults today do not know that 6 million Jews were killed in the Holocaust. Of those who are at least somewhat knowledgeable about the Holocaust, many don't understand that anti-Semitism not only caused the Holocaust, but it existed for centuries before the Holocaust. They don't appreciate that anti-Semitism looks a little different in each generation. Anti-Semitism morphs. The one constant is that anti-Semitism always seeks to pin whatever is that generation's greatest evil on the Jew. Because anti-Semitism always seeks to demonize, marginalize, ostracize, exclude, and cancel the Jew. First, the Jew was the Christ killer. For socialists, the Jew is the capitalist. For capitalists, the Jew is the socialist. For Nazis, the Jew was the race polluter. Whatever each generation finds most appalling, whatever that society views as the greatest evil, is pinned on the Jew. The Jew is demonized. Anti-Semites target Jews as the source of the problem. The Jew is blamed for society's misfortune and for all that is bad. The implication is that if only the Jews would disappear, the world would be a better place. What is today's current evil? What is the issue that has upended our society today and led to riots in the United States? Racism, apartheid, settler colonialism. And lo and behold, who has society deemed the greatest offender of these evils? Not just individual Jews, but the Jewish collective. The Jewish nation state of Israel, the one and only true democracy in the Middle East, the one place in that region of the world where all faiths, all races, all ethnicities, all genders are equal under the law, that one country, the Jewish homeland, is singled out and demonized. That is today's anti-Semitism. But much of society today does not yet comprehend contemporary anti-Semitism. That is why the IHRA definition is so crucially important, because it teaches the world that anti-Semitism today is not limited to anti-Semitism that resembles the Holocaust. Anti-Semitism today also targets and demonizes the Jewish collective, the Jewish nation state of Israel. Erwin Cutler, the former Justice Minister and Attorney General of Canada, once said, and I paraphrase, Traditional anti-Semitism sought to marginalize and ostracize the individual Jew and deny him a place in society. Today's anti-Semitism seeks to marginalize and demonize the Jewish collective, the Jewish nation state of Israel, and deny it its place in the society of nations. So our first challenge is that much of society does not understand what anti-Semitism is. They can't recognize it. A second miscomprehension that makes it difficult to combat anti-Semitism today is that most people are either unable or perhaps unwilling to distinguish between a discussion of Israel's policies on the one hand and statements of support for the Jewish homeland that are, for many Jews, an expression of their pride in their Jewish ethnic identity on the other. Judaism is both a faith and an ethnicity. Jews share not only religious traditions, but also a deep historical sense of Jewish peoplehood. The Jews' history, theology, and culture are deeply intertwined with the land of Israel. In fact, over half of the 613 commandments in the Pentateuch are connected to the land of Israel and can only be fulfilled in the land of Israel. For centuries, Jews have not only prayed facing Jerusalem, they have prayed to return to Jerusalem. Zionism, as a political movement of the Jewish people, may have originated in the 19th century, but the desire and determination of Jews to return to their ancestral homeland in Israel is thousands of years old as Abraham, Moses, and the children of Israel's exodus from Egypt to the Promised Land. Zionism is as integral to Judaism as observing the Jewish Sabbath or maintaining a kosher diet. Of course, not all Jews observe the Sabbath or keep kosher, but those who do clearly are expressing important components of their Jewish identity. Similarly, not all Jews are Zionists, but for many Jews, identifying with and expressing support for the Jewish homeland is also a sincere and deeply felt expression of their Jewish religious and ethnic identity. When Jews express pride in the fact that there is a country where the national calendar is the Jewish calendar, so they do not need to take vacation days to celebrate their religious holidays, and students don't have to worry that they will have an exam on Yom Kippur or Shavuot. When Jews are excited that there is a country where kosher food is easily available, where the ancient Jewish language of Hebrew is the spoken language, where Jews are free to practice their faith with pride, where Jewish culture is flourishing, and where one can walk on stones that are the same stones that the ancient Jewish people walked on 3,000 years ago. That is an example of Jews celebrating their shared ancestry and ethnicity. It is not necessarily a statement of support for the political policies of the current government of Israel, and it is not a statement that suggests dual loyalty. Yet today, on campuses and beyond, Jews who express this support for a Jewish homeland, Jews who take pride in the accomplishments of the Jewish people, and who celebrate all that the Jewish collective, the Jewish nation state of Israel, contributes to the world in high tech, agriculture, medicine, art, science, and more, are being tarred and feathered as racist Zionists, supporters of apartheid, and settler colonialists, categories that are considered this generation's greatest evil. Today, Jews are repeatedly told that if they want to be good citizens of the world, if they want to join progressive movements and march for civil or human rights, for women's rights, LGBTQ rights, climate change or immigration reform, they must first shed this part of their Jewish identity, abandon their sense of Jewish peoplehood and ethnic pride, and disavow the Jewish homeland. No other community is charged such a high price for admission. Demanding that Jews shed any part of their identity as the price for admission is discriminatory and anti-Semitic. It is comparable to demanding that a Catholic student disavow the Vatican or a Muslim student shed his or her connection to Mecca. Excluding an individual in this manner on the basis of his or her identity is discrimination. It is time for the world to recognize that this is today's anti-Semitism. Combating anti-Semitism is a global human rights issue. Anti-Semitism undermines democratic values of respect, inclusion, and equality. It is a cancer that rots away at, decays, and ultimately destroys societies that fail to curb it. But it is not possible to effectively combat this enemy if we refuse to define it. And defining anti-Semitism requires us to recognize it in all of its manifestations. That means we have to understand that anti-Semitism comes from both the right and the left. It utilizes traditional anti-Semitic tropes to demonize not only individual Jews, but also the Jewish collective, the State of Israel. And anti-Semitism seeks to deny Jews rights to which all human beings are entitled, including the right to equal opportunity regardless of national or ethnic identity. Take, for example, the story of Rose Rich, the former vice president of the undergraduate student government at the University of Southern California, who became the target of an aggressive social media campaign to, quote, impeach her Zionist ass, close quote. She was forced to resign to protect her physical safety and mental health and was denied the opportunity to complete her term as vice president. Social media platforms today, therefore, must adopt the IRA definition in its entirety, including all of the examples it provides of contemporary anti-Semitism. The people who oppose this adoption are anti-Semites who don't want to be labeled as anti-Semites. They want to be able to preach anti-Semitism, but not be canceled as racist Jew haters. If social media companies carve out exceptions and recognize only some forms of anti-Semitism and not others, if they say, for example, that it's okay to demonize the Jewish collective by comparing Israelis to Nazis, or that it is acceptable to delegitimize Jews by denying the right of Jewish self-determination, a statement, which by the way, is the equivalent of demanding that Jews shed their historic yearning to return to Zion, then the social media companies will severely undermine their own ability to regulate online hate. Applying only parts of the IRA definition and not others is the equivalent of constructing a massive gate through which anti-Semites will drive a semi-trailer truck full of online hate. Utilizing the IRA definition as a guide does not mean squelching criticism of the policies of the government of Israel. In fact, the IRA definition explicitly states that, and I quote, criticism of Israel similar to that leveled against any other country cannot be regarded as anti-Semitic, end quote. The IRA definition does not prohibit anti-Semitic speech. It merely labels as anti-Semitic the attacks that utilize traditional anti-Semitic tropes or that demonize, delegitimize, or apply a double standard to the Jewish homeland. This is an opportunity for social media companies to not only regulate, but also educate. By utilizing the IRA definition, social media companies can teach the public what anti-Semitism is and how to identify it in all of its forms. Just as some platforms are beginning to label disinformation, social media companies can and should label anti-Semitic posts. Repeat and extreme offenders should be denied posting privileges. We will not succeed at curbing online hate until we can define and recognize it. Anti-Semitism is exploding on social media platforms and negatively impacting the communities in which we live. To protect our democracy, our children, and our future, we must act now. Let's take the first step by requiring social media companies to adopt the IRA working definition of anti-Semitism. Thank you.